So now what we're going to do is we're actually going to play with this in the browser. Now, you're not going to have to do telnet. In the old days, I mean, sometimes I would use that telnet command to figure things out when something wasn't working. But actually, the browsers have wonderful debugging capabilities. And so there is a developer mode that the first real developer mode was a thing called Firebug inside of Firefox. And but since then, all the other browsers are building native debugger modes. Sometimes you have to go in and tell your browser to show you developer mode in the dropdowns in each browser. So if you have to Google, turn on developer mode in Chrome, or turn on developer mode in Safari, or turn on developer mode in Firefox, you'll get it turned on, and then you'll be able to use developer mode. And what happens is when you go into developer mode, you see a second panel that shows you network activity and various other things. And you can do things like inspect the headers of web requests, okay? So let me just show you how this works in Chrome. It's a skill that you will want to figure out. Now, you won't always have view developer mode or developer console here, but you might have to do something in the preferences to read that. There are a couple things here. I'm going to focus on looking at the network console. And so this network console will show me all the network requests as they go by. So I'm going to go back to page one. I'm going to hand type the URL into, and so you can see the request response on this. So here we go. It went and made a request, and I can click on this request. Oops, that's not what I wanted. I double clicked on it, so it actually did it. And so you can see the headers. You can see that the URL, and this is directly from that HTTP. It did a GET request. It asked for this page, and it got a 200 OK, and from this address on port 80. So it saw how that all worked. The response headers, remember, those are the things that we were seeing. We saw when in last modified date, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And there also are request headers, which I didn't show you, that are part of, you send the GET request, and then you send the request headers, and that communicates things like what your default language is, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So I'm going to clear all this. I've disabled the cache, and I'm going to click on second page, and we see that it makes a request here. So the key thing is to get to the point where you've seen the request, and now you take a look at the headers. We're doing a GET, again, to the page2.htm. Got a 200 OK, the response headers, the request headers, okay? And so you should be able to, and if you go to a more complex page, like drchuck.com or web applications for everybody, let's do this, and I'll turn on the network console. And if I go to www.wa4e.com, you will see it's going to make lots of requests. So it requested the main page, it's some data, some CSS, etc., and it keeps requesting thing, and it looks like it made a total of 26 requests, 408,000 bytes, took 8.3 seconds, and so I can actually look at any of these requests. And as your applications get more complex, you'll have to page through here. Now, we can see that the original page was just get to the main page, the response, you can see the HTML that came back, you can see the headers that we sent, we can see the headers that we got back, and here you can see things like the language, our preference for language is English, and so the request headers are things that inform the web server. If I had a different preference for language, I could tell as I'm requesting a document, if this document's available in multiple languages, which language I prefer. And so you'll get used to scrolling through here. Some of these are just retrieving files. It's got a CSS thing. Here's the response. That's this data here. You know, here's an image. This is what an image looks like. The content type is an image/png. So this is a response header. So again, you can dig through all this stuff and you don't actually have to write telnet commands, and you can figure all these things out. And so getting to know how this panel works is important for you to be a good software developer, a good web developer. So get used to it, start figuring this out, okay? So we have talked about this request response cycle. We've talked about how you do it by hand. We've talked about how you can watch it using the developer console. But this is really the only beginning. because I'm focusing on the part where it's going back and forth between the web browser and the web server, there's so much more. Things that we're going to do in the browser, like HTML and CSS and formatting, and how to look up stuff in the document object model, how to run JavaScript and jQuery and then JSON, so many other things. Then there is the whole PHP bit, how we're going to talk and do code in the web server, running Apache and PHP extension and doing all the PHP code to format stuff and return it. And then we're going to have to learn about the database server and you know, SQL and how do we make tables and how do we join those tables together and how do we produce the data efficiently that the user wants to see. And so there's a whole lot. And so what you'll see throughout the rest of this course is this picture in various forms. And what I just showed you was, you know, somebody clicks here and it goes and sends a request to Apache. Apache would grab a file and send the response back, and then the response is parsed and then shown to us. That's what I showed you. A simple thing. There's a file sitting on a server and we're requesting the file. The GET request goes in, the HTML comes back. And so that's the simple one. It's going to get more complex, right? By the time it's all said and done, we will, the worst case, you know, very complex. We'll send a GET request. The GET request will be PHP code, which will be run in PHP. Code will happen in PHP. It'll call a database call with SQL. SQL goes across here. And then a row set or set of rows talks to the database, gets some stuff back, and then it comes back to the PHP code. Then the PHP code writes a bunch of stuff and sends it back. So the web page comes back and it comes back as a response. So this right here is where the request response cycle is happening. And then that's sent into parsed and put on the DOM, and the document object model is shown, but then some of the code's in JavaScript, and then the JavaScript can change the document object model, so your website page changes, and sometimes you'll even click something, and that'll go into JavaScript, and JavaScript will make its own request response cycle. I should probably change the color of that one, right? Right? JavaScript will make its own request, it'll make a request response cycle, that'll run some PHP, that PHP will do some database, it'll read some stuff, it'll come back, send some JSON back in this case, JavaScript will read the JSON, update the document object model, changing your screen. So, we're just at the beginning. We clicked a page, we did a GET request, it was a flat file, it came back, it was parsed, it was put in the DOM, and we saw it. But there is so much more to learn. So, our modern web applications are going to start with this basis of the request response cycle, and you know, there's a whole bunch of stuff that we have yet to learn. As I said before, if you use a framework like Angular or Ruby on Rails, they simplify some of this, but at the end of the day, all they're doing is you're still doing request response cycles, you're doing some of the work in the browser, some of the work in the server, some of the work in the database. It's just kind of a changing style. And so everything that you learn about the request response cycle by writing PHP, MySQL, JavaScript applications is actually equally applicable to any framework that you're ever going to use. Okay? Hope you found this useful. See you on the net.